Hello again, it's Derek from TK Gaming and the Unpopped Kernels, and I'm here to talk about another movie that has a place in my heart. If you've seen the first episode, I know what you're thinking, and no, I don't just love movies with hell in the title. I swear this is just a coincidence. Join me today to talk about Hellraiser. There is a lot to talk about if we were to encompass all of Hellraiser and Clive Barker. While I will touch on that a bit, the primary focus will be the first Hellraiser movie from 1987. This masterpiece of film would then have a fantastic sequel subtitled Hellbound, and then some other sequels subtitled Hell on Earth, Bloodlines, Inferno, Hellseeker, Deader, Hellworld, Revelations, and Judgment, as well as a cancelled Origins. There's also a reboot with Barker as a writer that nobody is holding their breath for anymore, and an HBO TV series. Barker wasn't involved with any of the movies past the second one, but Doug Bradley would at least go on to play the Hell Priest Pinhead until the 9th and 10th, where Pinhead was played by who cares. Over time, I did buy each and every one of them, but recently downsized my collection to this double pack of the first two on Blu-ray, this collection of 3 through 8 on DVD, and the most recent two, Revelations on DVD and Judgment on Blu-ray. There's also a very interesting collection of anecdotes about the first two Hellraiser movies in this Leviathan documentary. Now please join me in the Literature Corner.
Derek's special Literature Corner.
Of course I have to praise Clive Barker's genius because he is my favorite author. I own and have read all of his books and stories and love them. There's some extraordinary talent on display here, and even the worst of them I would describe as still pretty good. My favorite is Imagica, a story about fantasy worlds existing just outside of our own, sexuality, the power of women, and gods and goddesses. It's a fantastic novel I've revisited 100 times. Hellraiser is based on The Hellbound Heart, a novella with the notable differences like the lead Cenobite's features, how Frank comes back, Kirsty's relationship with Larry, or Rory in the book, and Julie described as a goddess of veritable beauty and not so much a witchy stepmother. This novel is followed up by The Scarlet Gospels. This focuses on expanding the lore of Hell and follows Harry D'Amore, a recurring character in Barker's stories. There's some other characters in Harry's group, but personally I find them a little weaker than one could normally expect from his work. I bought the UK edition because I liked the cover better, and even had Doug Bradley sign it when I met him at Comic-Con. Now remember when I said there aren't any good sequels to Hellbound? That was sort of a lie. There's a fantastic comic series that follows the second movie, written by Clive Barker and published by Boom Studios. It's a great and proper sequel to the first two movies. If this stack is a bit too thick for you, you can probably skip The Road Below and The Dark Watch. There's also a bunch of stories based in the Hellraiser universe by various authors in comic form, as well as a collection of short stories called Hellbound Hearts. Clive Barker doesn't just excel at grotesque bondage demon horror, however. He wrote a number of very different fantasy, romance, and even young readers' novels that are all just as enjoyable.
Now get out of my special literature corner.
When I was talking about Helldriver, I talked about the actors and actresses quite a bit because they had appeared in a lot of other movies I've seen. I wish I could do the same for Andrew Robinson as Larry, Claire Higgins as Julia, or Ashley Lawrence as Kirsty, but I've simply never seen any other movies they're in. Some of the Cenobites are in Nightbreed, the Barker movie based on the novel Cabal, and Sean Chapman, who is Frank, did a voice in the video game Crisis? That's all I got. This movie has such real characters that are so wonderfully acted, incredible special effects and design, amazing writing, and little things you might not notice until rewatching. Pinhead, or the Hell Priest, would become iconic despite how little focus there is on his character. I would even go so far as to describe Hellraiser as a romance, which isn't so far-fetched if you've read his novels, which very frequently focus on romantic relationships. Here's my romance movie synopsis before we go over the film. Larry and Julia attempt to stimulate their decaying marriage by moving into Larry's mother's old house. They discover that Frank, Larry's brother, has been squatting in the house. This causes Julia to reminisce about her affair with Frank just before the wedding, and the only thing re-stimulated is Julia's old lust for him. Through some incident, Julia discovers Frank is hiding in the attic, and learns that he is being sought after by a group of people that would do him harm. He seduces her to do whatever preparations are required to finally run off with him and elude his would-be killers. Will Larry or her feelings dwindling for him stand in the way? Will Kirsty, Larry's daughter from a previous and departed lover, make a mess of things when she discovers the adultery? Now, I may have worded things a little specifically and left a few details out, but none of that was a lie, so I hope you can see what I mean. Now let's take a brief look over the film and have some closing thoughts. The initial shot shows the purchase of a mysterious box in a foreign market, then it doesn't waste any time showing what happens if you use the box. We don't know who this is or what's going on, but you'll definitely want to know more. The results are this horrible attic with strange beings roaming around, and then before you know it, it's like nothing ever happened. Larry and Julia move into his mother's old house, attempting to re-stimulate their marriage. It could definitely use a thorough scrubbing, so Kirsty, Larry's daughter, elects to stay in a hotel room, but also because Julia gives her some nasty vibes. Julia is reflecting on her pre-wedding affair with Larry's brother, Frank, when Larry stumbles in with an injured hand, acting like an absolute bitch. Then proceeds a great scene of Frank reforming from the floor because Larry's blood seeped into his heart under the floorboards. It's a great use of practical effects and footage reversing to create this gooey and gross birth. Julia retires from the housewarming party early and discovers Frank. I love that instead of making the monster hidden and mysterious, this movie gives him character and puts him right in the light. The mysterious characters show up later. Kirsty notes Julia's sketchy behavior, shrugs it off, and heads home with a boy she met at the party. Julia agrees to help Frank. He needs to consume people to fully regain his body. At that same time, Kirsty has a premonitive dream. Julia lures a number of men home while Larry is out and murders them. She progressively gets better at it while Frank gets better at being alive? Frank warns Julia about the Cenobites, those spooky demons from the beginning. It's always nice to see more of them. After what might be the most awkward attempt at lovemaking I've ever seen, and believe me when I say I've been involved in some pretty awkward lovemaking, Larry asks Kirsty to try to warm up to Julia to help her with her odd and distant behavior. Kirsty investigates the house, suspicious of adultery, only to discover the truth that's much worse. She escapes Frank and makes off with the puzzle box, only to collapse in the street and wake in a hospital. She makes the mistake of playing with the box, but gains some interesting allies to thwart Frank. This is when we hear what's probably the most famous line.
The box. You opened it. We came.
Kirsty somehow breaks out, returns to the house, and finds that apparently everything is fine now and Larry took care of the problem. It's no secret that things are not as they would seem, and the Cenobites demand what they were promised. Julia dies in the tussle while Kirsty attempts to evade Frank wearing Larry's skin. The Cenobites get the confession they want and do away with Frank, but that's not enough. Set on claiming Kirsty as well, they pursue her through the hellbound house, but are banished away with the power of the box. One last struggle with the hall-wandering monster, and her world is returned to normal. The box is discarded, but it is swiftly returned to where it was purchased, continuing the cycle. And what a fantastic ride that movie is, and if you describe it exactly the way I said, you could trick your girlfriend into watching it with you. I feel like this movie still holds up so well, and that even the cheesy energy explosions at the end lend a certain charm. This movie never bores you despite mostly taking place in a single house. In Hellbound, you learn a lot more about Hell, its Lord Leviathan, and the Cenobites. Even Bloodlines, the fourth film, is pretty interesting for the origin story of the Lament configuration, or Le Marchand's puzzle box. The comic series that follows Hellbound really dives into Hell's lore, the origin of the Cenobites, and a dimension even lower than Hell. It also expands upon the weird hall-wandering beast and the skeleton dragon at the end. For a reminder of my recommended must-views, it is The Hellbound Heart and the Scarlet Gospel novels, Hellraiser and Hellbound movies, and the Hellraiser comic series published by Boom Studios. And I think that might be the best order to do it in, too. And don't forget to give Imagica a try, and the Abrat series is really good too. If you'd be interested in my video game stuff, check out the TK Gaming channel where I have plenty of video game content. And if requested, I might just do a playthrough of Jericho and or Undying. I had streamed them both ages ago, before I was publishing content, so I'd be happy to revisit them. I may even drag Chris and Rob into it. They're the two other hosts of the Unpop Kernel Show podcast where we talk about movies weekly. Be sure to tune in around October when I inevitably pick Hellraiser for us to watch and offer even more tidbits about the movie to the conversation. I hope you'll check out our podcast and my gaming stuff. See you next time. Now, do I have to do a circular motion or...